Well, we're continuing today our series looking at what makes a Baptist church, looking at some of the foundational principles and beliefs which shape our practice and our practice of our faith and how we organise ourselves as a church. So last week we looked at the first of the principles in our declaration principle, which was this, that Jesus, I'm just going to summarise it, that Jesus is the ultimate authority on all matters of faith and practice as revealed in Scripture, and that each church is free under the guidance of the Holy Spirit to interpret and administer his laws. So that's what we thought about last week, that's the foundation, and we're going to move on today to think about baptism. What it is and who it's for. Well, as we have shorter talks on Sundays now, and today we've spent time around the Lord's table, I'm only going to have time to make a few points about baptism today. So I'd like to unpack it more fully later in the spring. So some of the theological significance and the symbolism we'll look at later in the spring. So what is baptism? John Calvin wrote this. Baptism is the initiatory sign by which we are admitted to the fellowship of the church, that being engrafted into Christ, we may be accounted children of God. Moreover, the end for which God has given it is first that it may be conducive to our faith in him, and secondly, that it may serve the purpose of in other words, it's a point of entry to the church. It's helpful to our faith, and by it we witness to other people. So why do we baptize? Well, it's a command of Christ. I said last week that it's a command of Christ, and there is an example of Christ, which we've heard about already this morning, in his own baptism, and we have the example of the early church. The command of Christ in Matthew 28:19-20. And I think I said last week that our declaration of principle is very much based and comes from these verses. And Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." A command of Christ. So baptism is not an optional extra. Not about when we feel like being baptized, it's a matter of obedience. If we love Jesus, we will do what he commands. In fact, he says, "You are my friends if you do what I command." So baptism is a necessary step in the discipleship process. In fact, it really marks the beginning of the discipleship process. It's almost part of the conversion process, the coming to faith process. Paul Beasley Murray says, "We are not truly committed to Christ until we have committed ourselves to him in the waters of baptism." Like a wedding marks the beginning of a marriage, our baptism marks the beginning of our faith journey with Jesus. As in Scripture, so in practice, baptism doesn't follow teaching. Teaching follows baptism. I know sometimes we feel we need to reach a certain stage of maturity of faith before we're baptized. And that's not actually so. So if you've been waiting, wait no more. If you believe in Jesus, be baptized. The example of Christ. We heard at the beginning service from Graham reading to us about Jesus' baptism. And we heard that John questioned why Jesus had come for baptism. Jesus was sinless. So his baptism wasn't about being washed clean, but it was his first step in his journey to the cross. Even though it was there right at the beginning of his ministry, it was his first step in his journey to the cross, as he identified with us and our sinfulness. And for us, baptism is about identifying with Christ in his sinlessness as we become washed clean. So why was Jesus baptized? He says it's because it was the proper thing to do to fulfill all righteousness. In the Good News, it's translated, his reply to John is translated, "Let it be so for now, for in this way we shall do all that God requires." So if it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for us. Like Jesus, we must submit ourselves to God to do what God requires. And the third thing was the practice of the early church. This verse in Acts says, this is after, on Pentecost, when Peter has preached to people, this is their response. "When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, 'Brothers, what should we do?' Peter replied, 'Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.'" Part of the process of becoming a Christian was being baptized. Repent and be baptized. And we see it in so many instances. The crowd at Pentecost, a large number of Samaritans, the Ethiopian official, if you remember that, Philip running along and to the chariot and sharing the scripture, and then the official saying, "Well, is there any reason I can't be baptized there?" Paul was baptized by Ananias, Cornelius and his friends, Lydia, the Philippian jailer, Crispus and fellow Corinthians, and the Ephesian disciples of John. So many accounts in Acts when people come to faith, they are then baptized. So in New Testament times, there was no such person as an unbaptized Christian. In Corinthians, Paul writes, "We were all baptized," and then goes on to explain the significance of that. So what about baptism in a Baptist church? Again, there is a misconception about what Baptists believe about baptism, that we practice adult rather than infant baptism. But that sort of misses the point. Our baptismal practice stems from what Baptists believe about the nature of the church. Baptists believe in a believer's church. That is, that the church is a voluntary, gathered and covenanted community of believers. When we look at what the Declaration of Principles says about baptism, it says this: that Christian baptism is the immersion in water into the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit of those who have professed repentance towards God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for our sins according to the Scriptures and was buried and rose again on the third day. So this says something about how baptism is practiced and who is baptized. It says to us that baptism is by immersion, going in and under the water and coming out again afterwards, rather than being sprinkled. But we'll talk more about that in a moment. Secondly, it says that the people to be baptized are those who have professed repentance towards God and faith in Jesus. And then it specifies that Jesus died for our sins aerated and burnt again, which is what we symbolically see in the this baptismal pool that we go into death and rise again with Jesus. But in other words, a Christian, a believer, that is who baptism is for. So this is the distinction from churches who practice infant baptism. Baptizing children, we cannot make that decision or faith or understand that for themselves, where promises are made by parents. And I know that obviously I grew up in the Anglican church, so I was baptized as an infant, and then when I reached an age where I made my own decision, I was confirmed, so you do make that decision and confirm that in public confession. But if you remember that from last week, I talked a little bit about history, saying that baptism came out of the Reformation, and when the Bible was translated and printed in contemporary languages, people were able to read for themselves and came to the conclusion that the New Testament showed that people were not baptized as infants, but when they came to faith in Christ as believers. So age is not the issue. If you are old enough to understand and make a decision for Christ, to be counted as a Christian believer, then you can be baptized. Here at Cowes, under the carpet, is our baptismal pool. We practice baptism of believers and we use immersion. And there's a lot of biblical evidence for immersion. It fits with the symbolism of baptism. But actually, there's also evidence of other ways. And the amount of water is not crucial. If somebody had a health condition, for example, I would baptize them by affusion, which is pouring water over them. If you were somewhere where water was just not available in great quantities, then you can practice by effusion. So while I've always aimed for immersion, for me, and I expect a lot of practice now, what matters so much is not the quantity of the water, but the quantity and quality of the faith. The water is a very important symbol, and as I said before, that going down into the water and coming up is a really important part of what we believe and like to do. We're going to unpack all that over other weeks later in the spring. Anyway, so the Baptist Church is made up of baptized believers. So it was known as a believers' church historically, as opposed to a state church where everybody was baptized, whether they actually believed or not. So everybody back then, you know, we're talking centuries ago, when baptism came to be, we're talking about a time when if you were a citizen or wanted to be counted as a citizen of the state, then you were baptized into the church, whether that was a Catholic church or at that time the new Protestant churches. And if you didn't baptize your children, that would be seen as an act of political dissent, not just against the church, but against the state. And people lost their lives over these decisions at that time. However, over time things have changed, and as we noted last week, our congregation comes from all sorts of church traditions, and we have a mix of experience. And of course we will have a mix of experience of baptism. Some of us have been baptized as infants. Some of those may since have decided that they should be baptized as believers. Others have chosen to stand by their infant baptism and by their confirmation when they were of age to choose faith in Jesus for themselves. Perhaps some have not been baptized at all. We're going to talk about membership another time too, but just to say originally, and in some Baptist churches now, Only those who were baptized as believers could be members and take communion. But here in Kells, we have an open membership. So people who would like to become members of the church, who've not been baptized by immersion, may, at the discretion of the members' meeting, be accepted for membership based upon their own public profession. That is why we send a couple of visitors to people. If someone asks for membership, we send a couple of visitors to them to get to know them more if they've come newly to us. But also it's to hear their testimony that they are confessing Christ, that they know Christ as Lord. And as we've shared this morning, we also have an open table. The table is for anybody who has faith in Christ. Any believer can share in the Lord's Supper with us. Now, I know a lot of you know all this stuff, but I think we've assumed for a long time that everybody knows this stuff, and yet, as I say, all of us come from other traditions, and we don't. And in our efforts to be more inclusive and remove barriers to Christians coming in from other traditions and being part of the church family, sometimes I don't think we've spoken enough about what membership is or encouraged people to be members. And also I think we haven't talked about baptism either. And yet the footnotes in our constitution, when it talks about this discretion for people to be come who are not baptized by immersion, it does say that we should urge people to consider believers' baptism. And I think we've forgotten this. Back in the days, if you had a closed church where people couldn't be a member or take communion, I'm sure the minister would be very much urging people to be baptized. So, in a way, although we have an open table, I still want to apologize for our slackness. I want to apologize for not paying enough attention to baptism. As a youth worker here, it was something that I encouraged young people to do. And we prepared for baptism and we did that. But we haven't necessarily paid as much attention to it for the groomers. When asked people whether they have time or whether they would like to consider it. And along with that, I want to apologise for slackness about talking about where people are in their faith journey. Do you believe? Have you put your faith in Christ? Can you say Jesus is Lord? How can we support you in our faith journey, in your faith journey? But I hope now that we're getting back to being face-to-face, we can address that. And my role as pastor is to use a very old phrase. The job is the cure of souls. It's what you have called me to do, to help and accompany each one of you on your spiritual journey. So some of that is from the front, to teach and encourage and challenge and correct. But it's not just something morning, it's one-to-ones, and perhaps running courses and encouraging you to be part of small groups. So this morning, I'd like to invite you to hold me to that. This is what you call me to do, and that's what I'd like to be spending more of my time doing. And I'd like to start by encouraging any of you who believe, but who have not yet been baptized, to be baptized. I'm very excited to say that we have one person wanting to be baptized already. So it'd be wonderful later in the spring to have a service of baptism, and perhaps there'd be more than one person who would like to be baptized. I'd also like to encourage any of you who are wondering about faith to take that step, or at least talk to someone else, hear about it, and allow them to pray with you and talk with you and help you explore that. And let's remember that we actually, something else in the Baptist Church that we believe is the priesthood of all believers. questions in, questions of faith or doubt, he used to say. And sometimes there were things that then could be addressed by a talk or a discussion as part of the service. But we're going to end with my questions to you. Coming out of this, do you believe? Have you put your faith in Christ? And have you been baptized? I know this has been perhaps the teaching and preaching this morning, and I know a lot of you have been baptized and you know this, but if we always assume that we all know it, then those who don't miss out. And Sundays is really the only time we're together to talk about these things. And can I encourage those of you who are way out